Now, here's the thing. There were Rosicrucians here, no doubt about that. There were deists here, no doubt about that. My argument has been from the very beginning when discussing the whole concept is, I talked about hourglasses. Let's think about it. Turn the hourglass on its side. There are points in history where people of, even though we have about a 5% variance in what we believe in, have all realized that the common threat is what we have to come together for. Now, even Alexander Hamilton, a man who was a war hero, and now he's a war hero in his own right because he fought tenaciously in the American Revolution, was wounded. We know there's no doubt about it. Yet this man at the end of the Revolution, after the Articles of Confederation, and even as they were trying to create the Constitution of the Republic, openly talked about handing us back over to the crown.
Or making George Washington a king and a central bank.
Yeah, so the big thing is, there's actually an accounting of this at the Constitutional Convention.
Yeah, let's be clear. There were different blocks and different groups.
But for the right, for the moment, this is the thing, that even though they had diverse ideas at a certain point in time, and they changed. Men change. At that given point, from 1775 to 1783...
They were together.
They were together. And afterwards, I mean, I personally think that Byrd did us a favor when he shot Hamilton. The whole story of that is totally different from what they've tried to repaint on
the New York Channel. All right, sir, you say... Just finish up what you're saying.
Forgive me.
No, it's fine. We just got to get to the last few calls. Anything else, Alex?
Yeah, the conclusion I've come to is that the reason... sure, of course, there's a diversity of opinions among the founding fathers, and obviously Byrd did us a favor when he was doing away with a Federalist like Hamilton. But what I've come to find in my own looking at this is that most of the founding fathers who were liberty-oriented because they were Masons and Rosicrucians, even though now, obviously, those groups are allied with a very different type of agenda.
Well, let me break this down. The evil groups that were infiltrating and took over the Masons then needed to have the good guys under their control so they would recruit them into it as a control arm. Listen, I appreciate your call. I got to go here. Let's talk to Bart in Houston. You're on the air. Go ahead, Bart.
Well, guys, you know, I want to say first off that this information is critical, and I really think y'all are hitting on all cylinders. You know, we have to approach this at least in our own interior confrontation with this entire reality that it is a spiritual situation. And, you know, what really upsets me is just all of the semantics that people use. You know, you always use this quote, Alex, and I've used it as the bedrock of my understanding of dealing with the public, dealing with politicians, dealing with everything, is that by their works you shall know them.
Exactly.
Right. If they're locked in a churchianity and they're not practicing what they're supposedly learning, then they are a dead tree. They are not actually bearing any fruit of what it is that they are taking in. And that is one of the key things that you can recognize in people that are either at, you know, I don't care if they don't even know about the New World Order. If they're out in the street and they are utilizing that dynamic human spirit, that spark of God's creation that's in us, which is the ability to create in this reality, the ability to use our minds to reach into this reality.
In our precious limited time, like Mark always talks about, you don't get any more of that time.
That's right. God gives us only one pocket full here. It's like, you know, you guys all remember this. You can't reach into your pocket and hand a handful of seconds over to another man. Each person.
That's the whole thing. We have to burn. We have to burn, and I'm talking about myself, I'm talking about everyone that's trying to do something right now. We have to be the bonfires in the night. And
yes,
that's why it's so important for the information that y'all are getting out to be gotten out, but then to be applied in the real world.
No, I agree, and that's up to you guys. People say, Alex, do this, or Mark, do that. We're working as hard as we can. You know, we're putting out the info, we're listening to your info. It's all of us together, many hands make light work, and we have to all commit and realize... I mean, we're living in the most incredible time ever. We ought to thank God we're living in this time to be tested. And I appreciate your call. Call me back later, Mark. Bart, great points. Mark, your comments on what he was saying.
Well, again, and also this ties in with our last caller, too, about even, for instance, many of the founders being Masons. Okay, Washington said the Masonry of the continent and the Mason of New America were two totally different institutions, under the argument that perhaps there was, again, another agenda afoot. They all understood and they acknowledged the overall authority of God. The fact that if we don't answer to a higher being, if we don't answer to God, and we don't, just as was said here by this caller, apply what it is that we know, then somebody, that vacuum will be filled by something. And we know that it's, you know, the good and evil pull back and forth, that if we don't step in there and do what is right, is righteous, and do what needs to be done, that there is a power vacuum that will be filled with something totally different from what one
would. Evil succeeds because good people do nothing.
That's right. Failure to perform. And that's where we're, what we're talking about. And we must be well-rounded. We must be knowledgeable in the processes of the ethereal. The mind is a powerful tool. The spirit greater still.
Yeah, don't waste your time watching TV and screwing around, folks. Life is short.
And we're also in the physical world, which is the other half of this, which is why, one, all of you, the militia is the property of we the people. It is not the property of the state. We did not vote to go into the American Revolution, people. Tell me where there was a vote cast. There was one vote cast. A one-ounce mini-ball went downrange, and a whole bunch of votes went back and forth over the next few seconds at Lexington, and it was opposed and for, opposed and for. You know what? It started the revolution. The militia was the obligated force. They were the men standing there at the moment who saw the need. All of you out there must be part of the militia, as part of being a balanced man in living society.
Got to take a few final calls and let you go, Mark. Let's go to Mark in Michigan, another Mark. Go ahead, Mark.
Yeah, hey, Alex, Mark. Good to talk with you guys. I'm seeing the church. It seems the church is just falling asleep. They are asleep.
More than asleep, they're the problem.
Yeah. And, you know, I just wanted to bring up one thing about 1 Thessalonians 4:17. It's just about meeting the Lord in the air. And I did some study, you know, with the Greek, and that word to meet actually means to greet, you know, as a dignitary. So when the Lord does come back, when he does return, it will be just as a meeting, as a dignitary comes onto a tarmac of an airport. So that kind of blows the pre-rapture right out of the water.
Well, the reason I bring it up is this is not even a religious show. I mean, I'm a Christian,
I know.
I'm letting people know I'm sick of the copping out. I mean, I'm really getting tired of it.
Absolutely.
You know, because they claim they're good, but they're not fighting Dying Corps child kidnapping rings. You know, I don't want to slap them upside the head. Anything else, Mark?
That's it, Alex.
Thank you. Real fast, Chad in Michigan. You're on the air with Mark Kornke and then Bandit and Greg, and that's it.
Yes, thank you, Alex, for taking my call, and thank you, Mark, for being a guest today. It's been an excellent show. I was, back in February, was in Washington, D.C., happened to be at a hotel where there was a conference of police chiefs from around the nation, and grabbed one of their publications, and I, for whatever reason, just out of interest and curiosity, but I'm listening to you today talk about a possible false flag attack in Chicago, jarred my memory. I pulled up this magazine. And starting on page 48, there's a five-page spread showing how they're going to nuke Chicago and what the effects would be from the blast radius going out from there, and just very, very powerful information.
Yeah, they like to advertise, and they have a New Orleans as a drill. They then have a Chicago as a drill. Then they carry out the attack where they say they would. It's kind of like a, it's like Gary Hart's come right out and said, yeah, our government stages terror attacks, and he basically admits they did 9/11. It's like a laughing at you. We went and said, does the government stage attacks? And they said, yeah, sure do. You know, that's another thing. Why, again, for those of us they know are awake, they kind of take the mask off and go, yeah, you bet we murder you. There's nothing that you're going to do. Your slaves will never wake up. And they go, oh, back to the public. Hello, babies. Shut up. You're going to get you, patriots. Oh, hi, news. Hello. We're your friends. Oh, we're going to kill all you people soon. Oh, we're friendly. You want to comment on that, Mark?
That's exactly how they're operating right now, too. In fact, if you look at it, they'll even claim in the same breath that they didn't say what they said only a moment earlier.
Wait a minute. Have you seen Truth Rising, where we say, Gary Hart, you said in a letter to Iran that the government will stage terror attacks as a pretext to start war and that they better do what we say. Did you say that? And he goes, no, I did not say that. What I said is our government may stage terror attacks to start a war.
Nope.
But, I mean, what is that? Why do they do that, you think?
Well, the negative is supposed to be implanted in the subconscious, and the idea is that through routine reinforcement through television, the subconscious will register the negative but not listen to the data that's being processed as the stream.
And I've discovered the general public is in a mesmerized state, and I've seen studies of 30, 40 years ago, you only had 25% of people suggestible. Now it's like 65, and I've talked to people on the street, and I've tested it out. You can almost boss them around and be very calm because they are asleep. And then they do brainwave tests. Most of the public is in a dream state.
In fact, and the scary part is plug it in with additional data entry through the cell phones and all the other nonsense that's being utilized, and you can see the end result.
Zombies.
Don't forget the Prozac, Ritalin, Halcyon.
Chad, what else? What was the name of the publication?
It's called the Police Chief Magazine, and you can go to their website. It's policechiefmagazine.org.
And they talk about how Chicago will be nuked and how they'll take our freedoms and how...
Yep. Full graphs and color showing the mushroom cloud, the blast radius from downtown Chicago.
And that's why we've got to be federalized and take all the guns, because the citizens are bad.